My name is Dan Ceech from the Berks County Park and Recreation Department. Behind me stands the Gruber Wagon Works, Berks County-owned wagon manufacturing industry. And it stands here as a monument to the fine craftsmanship that made various farm and industrial wagons for the people of Berks County. It's located at the Berks County Heritage Center, which is on Redbridge Road, just off of 183 near the airport and GPU. Today we're going to go inside the wagon works and look at some of the tools, equipment, and processes that were part of manufacturing these various wagons. Mr. John Gruber, who is a grandson of Mr. Franklin H. Gruber, who built this wagon works in 1882, will be inside to help explain these processes to you. The Gruber Wagon Works was moved to the Heritage Center from its home just below Mount Pleasant along Licking Creek in December of 1976 by the Army Corps of Engineers. If it wasn't, it would have been lost beneath the floodwaters of the Blue Marsh Dam. So now it is here and preserved for all of us so that we can take a step back into history and view the various wagon building processes that went on here at the Wagon Works. We're standing in the bench shop of the Gruber Wagon Works. To my right is Mr. John Gruber, who is a grandson of Franklin H. Gruber, the founder of the Gruber Wagon Works. Morning, John.
Good morning, Dan.
Could you tell us what you have here on the table?
This is a scale model of a Gruber Wagon Works that I made as an exhibit of the wagon.
It is a box wagon?
It is a box wagon, and it's complete in every detail. Painting job is exactly the way it was, and we have wheels, and we have a front seat brake, a back wheel slide, and we have a second brake in the back. You turn
right
that
here.
On down.
Hope it don't break in here. Well,
a little tighter, a little tighter.
Like that. There we go.
There's a brake, and you have your wheel, and the
the coupling pin
can be dismantled, and the pin to hold the tongue in will, as a wrench on the end, that you can remove your wheel.
Very lifelike. What scale is this?
This is 1/12th scale.
Of a original?
A 12-foot wagon.
And what were these wagons used for?
These wagons were used originally to haul things to the mill, grain, and coal or anything else, wood or anything else they had in the farm.
That they needed to haul, they'd use
that? That had to be hauled.
Kind of like a pickup truck.
The seat is removable, and the flare boards are removable, and the tailgate can be removed.
Right now, we'd like to go over to the wheel pit and give you an example of how perhaps some of these parts, especially these wheels, were manufactured. John, would you explain how a wheel is built here at the Wagon Works?
This is a hub of a big wheel. It is made, the hub is made out of gum wood, and the spokes are hickory. And there are 14 or 16 spokes to a wheel. So the one spoke is driven in, and then they have a guide here, and they take a second alternate spoke and drive this in with a sledgehammer. And in order to get the spoke straight, a man will sit on the bench here and guide it to the right or to the left, so all the spokes are straight in the wheel. So they go around the wheel and get half the spokes in. Then they come back and do the other half, put the other half of the spokes in. The wheel is brought from the front of the shop and placed in this machine, which is an entire wooden-made machine made by the Grubers. And it's mounted in this fashion. And then a circular saw is mounted into the spindle, and the spokes are cut off one after another to the exact length, so the wheel is perfectly round. Then they insert a different spindle into the machine and clamp each spoke in succession, thus, and bring the cutter in and cut the tenon on the spoke. Here's a tenon from a spoke that was taken out of a wheel. Then the wheel is taken to the front of the shop on the bench, and they attach and they mark and attach the fella to the spokes. Then they bring it back to this machine a second time and use a different cutter to true up the wheel so it's perfectly round. It'll cut the fella and the spokes all nice and smooth. And then from here, the wheel is taken to the blacksmith shop and the tire is mounted there. A rim to hold the iron is called a fella, so they have to determine where the different spokes had to be attached to the fella. A tenon is, each spoke is marked with a pencil very carefully, and then after it's marked for all the spokes, it's taken to another machine where a drill, a round hole is drilled through the spoke, through the fella for each one of the spokes. After that is done, they bring it back to the wheel here and they fasten it, starting at the one end, and drive it into the end of the hub, into the end of the spoke, and then to get the next one, they have a little tool like this, and they pull the next spoke to the first one and hammer that one in and come back and get started this way and gradually ease the spokes to each one of the fella and hammer them in gradually, and then they do the other half of the wheel and attach them. And then they had to be spliced so they actually fit perfectly against each shoulder of the tenon. This is a spoke turning machine. The top spoke is a pattern and the bottom part is a rectangular piece of wood, happened to be a hickory wood for a spoke, and then one sweep of the machine, a complete spoke is made. This is a mortising machine, and it's used to make a rectangular hole in a piece of wood, and the way it's done, it's just clamped into a machine like this. And then the hole is drilled. Number holes are drilled. Thus. And then they use a chisel here and they'll bring the chisel up and that's comes up and down and cuts the side. And you get it over to the line and then you release it. It don't come up. And as you leave it up to the other end, the chisel automatically reverses itself and you bring it up and swing it over to the other side and cut that hole square. But first you have to drill the holes. In that way it takes you only a few seconds to make a nice mortar from any size material.
We're standing in the blacksmith shop near the forge, which is right behind me. Here was where all the metalworking that had to be put in the wagons was accomplished. John, could you explain the process involved in working the metal here at the forge?
In the first place, you have to have a fire. And we have a fire in this area here. We're using bituminous coal, low sulfur coal for heating. Start the fire with wood shavings, and then they use a wheel here as a blower to get the proper draft on it, to get a good hot flame. And after a few minutes of starting a fire, you have a nice hot fire. Then you want to heat up some iron, You stick it in, heat it up, and bring it out, and use it on the anvil to hammer, or to shape, or do almost anything here. If pieces have to be welded, you take the two pieces of steel, put them in there, and get them to the melting point, and bring them out with tongues if they're long enough, if they're short, and take them on and weld them together and make one piece out of two.
Is that a form for any part of the wagon?
This is a particular hole. They take bolts. If they had to make a bolt, they can make a square head as a shoulder, or they can make it round, and then they can shape the head of the bolt. Then from then, they can take it over to another machine and cut the thread on the bolt. A lot of bolts were made in here, although many a time they just buy them because it's cheaper to do that than making them. And you have many different tools. You have a hardy here. This is a tool which is put in this way, and you can cut the iron in two by just hitting it on there. And then if you want to make something round, you can put the stake in here and bend it around here, but it has to be hot unless it's very small material. Some things can be shaped cold, but usually it's best to have heat on there, and it's much easier.
So initially everything had to be heated and work while it was hot, and then taken back to reheated.
And to handle the tool, the things, we have a lot of handmade tongs here. This is made to hold round steel. Shouldn't have an anvil like that. That's the wrong tool, so you can put one here. Here's a tongue made so you can get a hold of a round piece of steel, heat it up, take it over here, shape it, hammer it.
Eventually, didn't the Grubers acquire machinery that could work metal while it was cold instead of having to heat it all the time?
The only thing they could do with that is to have a tire for a wagon that is always bent in a rolling machine. Taking a straight bar of steel, the size of the tire you want, you can put it in a machine and roll it through with a bar and make it in a circular shape. And then it's brought back to the fireplace here and welded together.
Machinery in the wagon works was powered by a mainline shaft system. Originally, that was run by a small water turbine, and then in the 1890s, they switched to a combination of a turbine and a steam engine. In 1906, after they finally acquired more metalworking machinery here in the blacksmith shop, they bought an auto gasoline engine, and that then was the final power source for the machines. The shaft system here in the blacksmith shop has been extended overhead. You can see the belts that are attached to the shaft system that go through the shop and, of course, are powered by the auto gas engine. In front here is a very large machine. It's a power punch and shear machine. And John, if you could explain a little bit about this machine.
This machine will cut punch holes instead of using a drill and a drill press. You can punch holes like this particular piece of metal was made for part of a shop, part of a wagon. There were different size holes, and they put this right in a machine like that, and the die comes down and just presses a hole into the metal cold. And then they have all these different tools that they can make different sizes and shapes of holes, and you can punch holes into material, cold steel, like this. This happens to be a 2-inch by a quarter, and you can easily punch holes right into that steel, or you can even make a brake part. I don't see the cutter now, but there are dozens of different heads here. By changing the die and the punch, you can make any size material. On the other side of the machine is a shear, which you can see from this end. And I can take this cold piece of steel and stick it in the machine and punch, comes down, cuts it right off cold. And you can cut off material up to 5/8 of an inch by 2 inches cold without any heating at all. So that's a very good time saver. Instead of heating it up in the forge and using a hardy and cutting it and bending it, they immediately cut it off cold. By placing it in a machine here, and then by means of operating this machine, they have 18 hydraulic presses here, and they all work together and compress the band, the tire band, so that it'll get smaller. They lay the iron in first and get the pressure on and see that it's perfectly round and straight. Then they put the wheel on, and then it can be a quarter or half an inch oversized, and they immediately compress the molecules of the steel and make it smaller and make it tight. In order to do that, they have three hydraulic presses back here, and here's a control lever. By turning this, they can either turn the fluid on. These 18 cylinders compress, move in and out a matter of about an inch and a half. And if they have a big wheel, they put small blocks in here. If it's a large wheel, they take smaller blocks. There are a set of sizes they can make from a foot and a half in diameter up to the diameter of the blocks here, which is about 6 feet.
This is the finished product. What we have here is a Gruber hay flat. You can see the decorative painting, striping that goes on it. The body is green and the chassis here is red. You can see also all the ironwork that has to be taken into account here in the blacksmith shop. Also here, this is the tongue that goes in here. This is the toolbox. A pair of uprights went back here to help keep the hay in line, and a seat would sit on top here. Now the Gruber wagons are stamped here with the serial number, which helps indicate who bought it and the date and what kind of wagon it was. That's it.
This is a corner of the paint shop where wagons were brought up in the elevator, and this is the area where they were given three coats of paint and then decorated, striped, varnished. And after that they were moved to a storage place somewhere. The paint was kept in buckets here, and they had an outfit here where they kept the brushes overnight in water. In the daytime, when they come in the morning, they took them over to this area here and cleaned all the lead paint out of the brushes, and sometimes it was built up with paint up to 3-4 inches in thickness. And one time they even had to take an axe and chop it out, and it's built up again. Painting a wheel, so oft times it was more convenient to take it off the way axle and bring it here, and the painter painted right here. After a period of time, they also had hay flats up here, but they could get only about two hay flats in here to paint at one time. After that, they took them back into the next department where they were stored until they were delivered. And for paint, they needed a lot of heat up here, and they had an old pot belly stove as a heating facility here. One of the big problems was here is to keep the dust out of this area. So many times they sprinkled water on the floor here and keep the dust down.
This is a large box wagon that was made for Wagner and Emmerich in Wummelsdorf about 1916. You can see the paint on the side and also the flare boards that allowed more cargo to be placed in these. The driver would sit in this seat, and on the far side was a handbrake that was also used in conjunction with a rear brake. This wagon was pulled by two horses and evidently gave a lot of use. After the Army Corps of Engineers moved the Wagon Works to this location at the Heritage Center from the Blue Marsh area near Mount Pleasant, they restored the Wagon Works to its capacity in 1910 and 1920. In a ceremony in 1980, the title was transferred from the federal government to Berks County. I'd like to thank John Gruber for making himself available for this taping and helping us out with all the little itty-bitty parts.
I thank you very much for letting me do it, please.
Thank you, and John will be around all summer as we will. The Wagon Works is open, and the hours are Tuesday through Saturday, 10 to 4 in the afternoon, and on Sunday, 12 to 5. We're closed on Monday, and admission is adults, $1, students, 13 through 18, 50 cents, and children under 12 are free. Tours are conducted by volunteer guides who have put in a considerable amount of time training, and they take small groups of 8 or 10 people through the Wagon Works. I'd like to thank everybody for viewing this program and hope that it'll stimulate your interest to come out and see the Wagon Works and take a tour.